Thanks a lot. Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. And I should probably start, I usually start by trying to convince the audience about the fact that we are leaving these days an enormous amount of digital footprints behind while using digital products and services, such as your smartphones, your Facebook profile, your Fitbit or other fitness tracker, increasingly also those more traditional tools such as your car that is now also recording not only your driving but also what's happening on the road. And we are generating an enormous amount of digital footprints in this way every single day. Back in 2012, IBM estimated that an average person is generating 500 megabytes of digital footprints every single day. And it's an enormous amount of data, especially if you multiply by a number of people around. And just to help you imagine how much data that is, let's have the following thought experiment. Imagine that you wanted to back up one day worth of data that humanity is leaving behind on paper. Letter-sized, font size 12, Times New Roman, single line, double-sided. How tall will be the stack of paper that contains just one day worth of data that humanity is producing? Do we have any consultants in the room? Any guesses? It will be tall. Come on, help me out here. To the sun. Great. That's, no one has ever started with the sun. The furthest people go is the moon, usually. It's like from the Earth to the sun four times over. It's just a great guess. It's just a great estimate. I'm sorry, great estimate. It's just one day worth of data. And of course, we're very quickly ramping up our ability to produce data. Recently, The Economist estimated that in 2025, we'll be generating 62 gigabytes of data per person per day. And we're also going to have more people, which means that we'll need much better technology than paper to back it up, not to mention probably all of the paper will be gone after we backed up data in 2012. Well, so what can we do with those digital footprints? And I'm sure that you are aware of many different applications of big data sets of digital footprints that we are generating. Those data sets are being used to predict movements of the prices on the stock markets. They are being used in medicine to diagnose disease. They are being used to design very useful things, such as self-driving cars that those autonomous driving cars, they rely to a large extent, the AI that's driving them relies to a large extent on the data that is being generated by the drivers. So for instance, Tesla's business model is not only to sell you a car, but also to collect the data that you are generating while driving this car. And in this way, they can produce much better autonomous systems for the benefit of you as a driver, but also of the future drivers. Now, me personally, as a psychologist, I focus on uses of big data in psychology. So my main question I try to answer in my work is trying to understand humans better through the lenses of the big data sets that we are generating these days. And in my work, that's what psychologists usually do. They try to understand humans better, understand their traits, their psychological traits, and also predict future behavior. And now there's, of course, many angles that you can take while looking at such models predicting psychological traits and future behavior. One that I'm going to tell you more about today focuses on privacy, what it means for the privacy of all of us when algorithms can get really accurate at judging our intimate traits, revealing our intimate traits, and predicting future behavior. And I will start with a research project from 2013, where we took Facebook likes, one of the most generic type of digital footprints. I assume that everyone here in the room knows what Facebook likes are. This is this little button with thumbs up that you can find underneath any Facebook content, such as the funny goat picture that your cousin published, or maybe a picture of your new nephew that was just born, or status updates of your friend, and so on. Now, those Facebook likes are also present in other places on the web, like you can go to a website of a restaurant and click like button indicating well, that presumably you liked the restaurant. And in this way, those Facebook likes are very similar to many other types of digital footprints, such as your credit card records that essentially create a connection between you and a product that you have purchased, or maybe website browsing logs, that where those data sets would contain connections between you and the websites that you have visited. Now, in fact, one can argue that Facebook likes are much less revealing than other types of digital footprints. There are many websites you would visit that you would not like on Facebook because you know that other people are watching and the website might be too intimate or maybe just too boring for you to be willing to share it with your friends or like it publicly on Facebook. There are many things you would buy using your credit card, maybe things that you have no choice, you have to buy, like medicine, that again, you wouldn't reveal this fact to your friends on Facebook by means of liking it. So one could argue that whatever models we can build on Facebook likes, there could be, their performance could be beaten by the models that were built on more revealing data. And as I've been talking already for quite some time, let me show you a short video clip summarizing the results of this early research where we used Facebook likes to try to predict future behavior and intimate traits of a population of around 60,000 people.
Now, clicking like on Facebook is something most of us do without thinking.
The University of Cambridge over in London actually did a study
of what people like on Facebook to try to determine facts about them that they wouldn't otherwise know. So they didn't just look at the products, the movies, the bands that people like. They also looked at the status updates that people liked, the photos that people liked. And they were able to draw some really, really interesting conclusions about
all of your likes that you're clicking can tell more about you than you might have realized, from your political values to your religion to your gender to your happiness to your age.
In fact, some parts of your identity can be predicted with 95% accuracy.
Accuracy was lowest, about 60%, when it came to predicting whether a user's parents were still together when they were 21. People whose parents divorced before they were 21 tended to like statements about relationships. Drug users were ID'd with about 65% accuracy, smokers with 73%, and drinkers with 70%. Sexual orientation was also easier to distinguish among men, 88% right there. For women, it was about 75%. Gender, by the way, race, religion, and political views were predicted with high accuracy as well. For instance, white versus black, 95%.
The findings have alarmed privacy campaigners who fear this research could be used to commercially exploit users.
So keep in mind that just because you think you're not revealing a lot of personal details on Facebook, you're still spreading the word to the outside world as well as those online marketers.
Volunteers with few friends liked walking with your friend and randomly pushing them into someone or something. Hey, it's not their fault they don't have friends. Everyone they know keeps getting randomly pushed into traffic. High IQ corresponds to liking Mozart, science, and the Colbert Report.
Research indicated people who like Harley-Davidson motorbikes are generally of low IQ. We thought we'd better offer a right to reply.
I'd say our average customer is probably more intelligent than most, and we've certainly got a lot of customers who are, well, people from Cambridge University for a start.
A like on Facebook can reveal if you're a gay man. Yeah, especially if what you choose to like is penises. That's my wife walking in. I'm like, oh! It's a joke.
Okay, by the way, don't be an idiot and think that if somebody clicked on Wicked the Musical that they're gay automatically, or they clicked on Harley Davidson and they're stupid automatically. Ironically, that would make you stupid.
So, as you could see on this video, as our reports show, those seemingly innocent digital footprints, Facebook likes, when run through a relatively simple algorithm, in fact, we're not using anything too fancy, can reveal an enormous amount of intimate data points about an individual. And of course, it begs the question, how do those prediction models work? And I have this equation here that should make it really clear. But before we dive into it, in case we have some Harley Davidson owners in the audience,
this is.
We all know. let me start with this example here. Imagine an anonymous user, and you know nothing about them apart from the fact that they like Hello Kitty, the brand. Now, can anyone tell me, what is your guess? What would be their age and gender?
Female.
Female? So judgmental. In fact, the person that has most Hello Kitty toys is this retired Japanese gentleman. Now, but you are right, judgmental by right. When you look at the stats, and this is not a, this is just can be just checked on Facebook website. When you look at what is the distribution of age and gender for people who like Hello Kitty, you can see that 99% of people who like Hello Kitty are women. Which means that if you know nothing about a person, just they're like Hello Kitty, you will be right 99% of the time if you said, well, this person must be female, and also a young female to it. Okay, so what do you think is their job title? Do they work in sales or in the military? Sales, judgmental again, and correct again. You can see that people working in sales are very highly overrepresented among those who like Hello Kitty. Would they use a PC or an iPhone? Of course, most of the Hello Kitty fans don't even know what PC stands for. That's not the right age group. So as you can see here, just by knowing one digital footprint of an anonymous person, you can make an enormous amount of accurate psychodemographic predictions that would be pretty accurate. Now, you don't need to be a psychologist or a computer scientist or an algorithm to do that. And of course, in the case of most of digital footprints, the task is not as easy. Take Forrest Gump, the movie, for example. It's much more popular of a like. Most of the people out there like Forrest Gump, and if they don't, there's something must be wrong with them, because it's just a great movie, and I'm a big fan myself. But you can see that among people who like Forrest Gump, there's also overrepresentation of men and slightly older men as well. So if you use one fact about a person, that they liked Forrest Gump, a safe bet would be to say they're male and probably also in one of those older age groups. Would you be as accurate when making this judgment? When given Hello Kitty as a digital footprint? Of course not. But now algorithms are great at taking those little pieces of information from each digital footprint that we reveal to them, putting them together to arrive at the accurate prediction, something that humans actually can't really do so well. So now, given that we are leaving hundreds or thousands of digital footprints every single day, they are being recorded by marketing companies, platforms such as Facebook or Google, the producer of your smartphone, your government, foreign spy agencies. Now, they can use very simple algorithms to put this data together and arrive at very accurate predictions. Now, the question is, how accurate are those predictions? So let me show you a plot here from our 2013 paper that shows how the accuracy of the model grows, and in this case, the model predicts personality, which is one of the models, one of the frameworks that psychologists would use to describe individuals. And personality traits are such as neuroticism, conscientiousness, openness, agreeableness, extroversion. Most of those traits are really intuitive. You don't need to be a psychologist to kind of have an intuition of what a given trait means. Personality is one of the best predictors of what job you would excel at, what psychological disorder you may be at risk of suffering. Also, it's a great predictor of how to, which marketing communication you would be most susceptible to. So personality is a very useful model, useful framework used by occupational psychologists, marketers, and so on. Traditionally, personality was measured with questionnaires. There was a typical personality questionnaire would have 100 questions, some of them go up to 300 and above. So you can't really use it, let's say, in marketing. It's very difficult to imagine someone coming into a store and being handed a 300-item personality questionnaire and asked or expected to answer it, especially if you want honest responses. No one would be willing to share any intimate responses, intimate data about themselves in such context. So what we wanted to see here is whether you can estimate personality using digital footprints instead of questionnaires. And what you can see here is we are this plot represents the accuracy of predicting your score on a personality questionnaire given the number of likes that we are revealing to the model. And as you can see, the more likes you reveal to the model, the more accurate would be the prediction of your score on a personality questionnaire. And I assume that we have no psychometricians in the room. If there were some psychometricians, I would get some wows here, because this is an amazing accuracy. This accuracy is really high. And let me illustrate it using the following comparison. Let's compare the accuracy of the like-based model with an accuracy of another accurate way of judging people's personality. And this is asking others, asking your acquaintances, friends, family members to infer, predict your personality. And one could argue that if you hang out with someone at work, or if you spend time with your family, over time, they would be able to learn how extroverted you are, or how conscientious you are, or how open-minded you are. You could actually say that this, in a way, defines knowing someone. You could define knowing someone as, or you can measure how well you know someone by asking you to say whether this person likes poetry. And if it's a complete stranger, well, you're just reduced to guessing. But if someone that you know very well, you'd be able to answer this question accurately. And now, this is also how you measure personality. You ask people questions such as, hey, do you like poetry? Or are you arriving at the meetings on time? Or do you like hanging out with friends in coffee shops? Those would be questions used to measure personality. And in this case, we ask both a computer to anticipate people's responses to those questions, and we ask the friends and family members to anticipate their responses to such questionnaire. Now, can you guess how many likes do you need to reveal to an algorithm for an algorithm to be as accurate as your work colleagues at predicting your responses to a personality questionnaire?
If I know, it's with 10 likes they understand us, after 50 likes they can understand
totally. Well, totally, I would say that they probably never can.
Suggestion.
Yes, great. Thank you for being acquainted with this study. Yes, 10 likes is enough for an algorithm to be able to anticipate your responses to a questionnaire as well as your work colleagues can. Now, how many likes do you need to outperform your friend or a family member? You're banned from responding from now on. 50, great. 50 to 100 likes. And again, we are talking about likes on, you know, a picture of a funny goat or a status update of your friend. Revealing 50 of such digital footprints to an algorithm allows the algorithm to anticipate your responses better than your friends and family members. Now, the most accurate of the judges, your own spouses, can be outperformed with an algorithm that has access to around 250 Facebook likes. Now, think about it for a second. This is, to me as a psychologist, it's a bit of an upsetting finding, in fact, because this means that the person that probably knows you the best in life, person that spends enormous amount of time with you, knows you across different contexts, that you have intimate conversation with, that you open to, person that, if you were married recently, that still pays a lot of attention to you, this person doesn't know you as well as an algorithm that would have access to 300 or 400 of your Facebook likes. And 300 or 400 Facebook likes is approximately as many as a 16-year-old generates in a day today, right? So And psychologists probably wouldn't be anywhere close to your spouse when judging your personality without the help of a professional psychometric tool, which essentially means the bottom line here is those algorithms are extremely accurate. And as you probably all know by now, it's not use of such algorithms, studying such algorithms is not just limited to psychological labs. They are being widely used out there in both political marketing and marketing, and have been used for the longest time. In fact, when I was running this study in 2013, I learned about the existence of such algorithms from my conversations with people who are studying marketing or working in marketing industry. The one problem is that when you listen to what marketing industry people are telling you, you don't really know whether they're lying to you or telling you the truth, right? Because when they say, oh, our algorithm is so good, well, maybe they're just saying. And sometimes where they say, oh, don't worry, our algorithm doesn't work at all, well, the question is then why would people spend millions of dollars to pay you for the use of this algorithm? But, you know, they might be just trying to be less controversial. And now, of course, I mentioned it before, there are many other types of digital footprints apart from Facebook likes, and much better than Facebook likes at revealing your intimate traits and future behavior, like language. What you can see here are two word clouds representing words that are most predictive of being, well, liberal or conservative. And models based on language use that can be recorded on Facebook, like in the case of this study, but can be also recorded from Twitter, from your email, from your phone calls and so on, such samples are not only easily obtainable, but also as you can, well, you can't see here, I won't show you this slide, but allow predicting personality with accuracy higher than whatever can be achieved using Facebook likes. And you would be delighted to know that companies such as Facebook, you can see patents granted to Facebook back in 2012, that essentially is for predicting your personality from language used in status updates and your communication through through Facebook. And there are many other systems like that. IBM Watson here, for example, for many years offering an API where you can upload sample of text and API will give you back a detailed psychological profile of the author of the text. And now we could talk for hours about different types of digital footprints that enable such predictions. One of the type of digital footprint that's even I found that it was surprising that it can be revealing about intimate traits is digital images of our faces. Now, internet is full of images of our faces, selfies, profile pictures, Instagram accounts, they're all overflowing with images of faces. And now it turns out that your face can also be revealing about, revealing of your intimate traits. And when I say that, especially when I say that in the crowd filled with social scientists, the reaction is usually, oh my God, this can't be true. How can you say such awful things? Of course, our faces are not revealing anything about ourselves. But wait a moment, gender. Everyone here in this room can very easily judge other people's gender from even the shortest exposure to their face. Emotion. Emotion is an intimate psychological state. Humans excel at judging emotion from people's faces even when others try to hide their emotion. Right? Most of us wouldn't have trouble guessing what the president is feeling here. Now, the range of genetic disorders and developmental disorders, all of those things can be predicted from other people's faces, which essentially means that we humans are great at judging other people's, predicting other people's intimate traits just based on an image of their face. But now we are not really good at predicting some of the intimate traits. For instance, personality. If I asked you to judge, to guess, which of those two famous psychology researchers is more extroverted, you'd be actually right, but maybe only 52, maybe 54% of the time, right? So there's clearly some signal that we can recognize, but it's not enough to make judgment of any worthwhile accuracy. Now, it can mean two things. Either there's no information related to your psychological traits such as extroversion in your face, or maybe human brain or human eyes are not good at perceiving or interpreting signal that is revealing of our intimate traits such as extroversion. And it seems that it's the latter. What you can see here is you can see 10 faces of introverted women and 10 faces of extroverted women overlaid on top of each other. There's no computer science, computer vision magic here. It's just 10 images overlaid on top of each other. And now no one would have any trouble guessing which of those 10 women were extroverted and which of these 10 women were introverted. Any guesses? Which group is extroverted? Right. Right, great. You can see different facial expression. You can see makeup. You can see better hairdo and dyed hair on the right. You can see, I mentioned smiling. You can also see that extroverted women have no nostrils. Any guesses why extroverted women would have no nostrils? Pardon this. I thought about this. Smiling doesn't obscure your nostrils. Look great. If you had to take home just one thing from this talk, extroverted women know about taking selfies. And if when you take selfies, you should be taking them like that. It makes your face look much better. But now when you look more closely, and since then I've conducted quite a few studies where we invited people to the lab, measured their personality using a question in the lab, and then fixed the position of their face, covered their hair, asked them to remove makeup, and took pictures in this way, you can clearly see differences in the shape of their jaw, in the shape of their nose, in the shape of their eyebrows, and so on. So even morphology of the face differs between introverts and extroverts. And again, predictions of this kind are not limited to what's happening in the at the universities. You can see, for instance, Microsoft Cognitive Services, but it's just one of many that offer facial detection, but also technology that can, in this case, predict your emotion from your face. Which brings me to the last point that I want to make today. I hope that I convinced you by now that algorithms are getting really good at turning digital footprints into accurate predictions of our intimate traits and behaviors. Now, on the other hand, we are increasingly migrating to the digital environment, to the digital world, leaving behind even more digital footprints with every day, which essentially means that going forward, there's going to be just less privacy. Algorithms would just be getting better and better at revealing our intimate traits and predicting our future behavior. And now, when I say that, usually what people think or say is like, well, okay, maybe we'll have some creepy marketing out there. But then on the other hand, if we just work hard and we give people tools and we introduce right laws, maybe we could regain the control over our data. And now the answer is no, we're not going to be able to do that. Even the governments and large institutions struggle to control their data. How would you expect common citizens like us here in this room to have enough time and enough knowledge and enough technological sophistication to be able to protect your data from being stolen by a motivated third party? Especially then, to a large extent, our data is now, we give our data, store our data on platforms that are kind of, to some extent, not dependent on us or that we cannot control. Now, moreover, if you somehow magically could control your data fully, there's still a lot that we want to share. I want to be able to tweet. I want to be able to post things online. I want to be able to speak publicly and have my face and my voice recorded. I want to walk the streets being filmed by the CCTV cameras without covering my face. And this is already more than enough data for even a simple algorithm to be able to reveal intimate data about me. And again, when I reach this stage of the presentation, usually the audience says, well, okay, I mentioned it before, maybe we'll have to put up with some creepy marketing. maybe we have to put up with marketing companies being able to reveal our personality. But my point here is that it's not as simple as that. And to illustrate it, I created those two composite faces. So there's two groups of 100 men. Those faces are averaged using a computer algorithm. And those men differ on a very important psychodemographic variable. Can you guess what variable that is? That's not the one. Great guess, but it's not the one.
Sexual orientation.
Sexual orientation, thank you. Those are faces of 100 straight and 100 gay men. So when we average those faces, even humans, once they kind of got notice some differences, are able to do it, but humans are very bad at judging other sexual orientation just based on their faces, very much like humans are bad at judging people's personality based on their faces. But now a computer algorithm can distinguish between straight and gay men with over 80% accuracy given one image and over 90% accuracy given five facial images, which, when you combine it with this map showing you in which countries you can be killed for being homosexual, proves the point, or makes the point, that losing our privacy is not just about some creepy marketing. It's literally a matter of life and death for many people around the world. Which brings me to my absolutely last slide, showing this beautiful tornado here. Look, we can all agree that tornadoes should be illegal. And I will be the first to support legislation making them illegal. It's just that whatever we decide here to do about tornadoes when it comes to delegalizing them, they will still keep coming. And it's very much the same with losing our privacy. We can all agree, and I'll be the first person to argue, this is why I study privacy and I spend so much of my time trying to educate people about those issues. I do care about our privacy, but I've lost, quite a few years ago, I lost my belief that if we just do a good thing, somehow we can bring privacy back. We essentially lost it. And the sooner people accept it, the sooner people realize that talking about legislation, talking about technology is not going to bring privacy back, the sooner we can start a discussion about how to make sure that our post-privacy world is still a safe and habitable place to live. And now, even if I'm wrong, and in fact, somehow in the future we'll regain our privacy, I believe that the world in which losing your privacy does not put you at risk of losing your life or losing your money or being taken advantage of is still a better world to live in. And I should stop here and open the floor to questions. I was asked to request that you guys raise your hands as high as possible and keep your questions to the minimum length. Thank you very much. Sir?
You first. I'm the guy with the Harley Davidson. Okay, my name is Euripides, I'm the High Commissioner of Cyprus. Seriously, you are describing to me an Orwellian world of different sorts. So Orwell must have been right in a lot more ways than we ever anticipated that he was. How are these things can be used against us, of course? What is the real downside of all these things in terms of terrorism? How, may I also ask, being a diplomat, I would not be true to my tribe if I were not to ask you, how do you think these things are also affecting diplomacy, where, of course, you have Cambridge Analytica, you have people tampering with these things and really giving you really fake news, giving the illusion that the algorithm is correct, because you can pump 400 likes when, in fact, you don't really like anything.
That's many questions. Bringing them up. So let me try to comment on some aspects of your question. So first of all, there's a common notion here saying, well, you know, I just like random things on Facebook. So how could algorithms know anything about me? Well, the answer to it is no, you don't. You don't like random things on Facebook. And this is for many different reasons. First of all, well, who in this room recently liked something that was like really far away from their ideological standing? Because people say, oh, my friend liked it, so I also liked it. Well, if your friend liked a Nazi, neo-Nazi party on Facebook, would you also go and like it? Of course you would not, hopefully. So that's the first thing, that we kind of much less random than we think when we like things on Facebook and when we leave digital footprints in other spaces. Not to mention that those platforms work really hard to show us only the content which we're likely to like or likely to enjoy, which kind of amplifies that whole process. The things you wouldn't like, you don't even see very often in the digital space. And also at the end of the day, even if you like random stuff on Facebook, well, the models still show that those likes, those random likes that you like, are really revealing about your intimate traits. Meaning that even if they're random, they're really revealing. By the way, they're not random. Now, you also brought the subject of Cambridge Analytica, and I'm sure that everyone here heard about Cambridge Analytica. This is the company that famously used the large data sets of people's likes to reveal their personality and then do exactly what I was warning against in my research in 2013. Now, it's very unethical what they've done, but what also people seem to be forgetting is that Cambridge Analytica is just one of the hundreds of companies that are doing exactly this, and in fact, it's probably one of the least competent of them. And let me give you a few examples of how incompetent they are. So they famously for me, because it put me in a lot of trouble, they mentioned once or said that their models were based on my work, they were inspired by my work. Well, if they read my paper till the end, where I was warning about privacy abuse of such data, they would have read that I said, well, Facebook likes are just one of those least revealing types of digital footprints. If you really want to invade people's privacy, what's really risky is credit card records, web browsing logs, search logs. So clearly they didn't even read the paper that they're supposedly being inspired with till the end. Also, you don't really need to collect Facebook likes yourself. You can just go and buy Facebook likes of millions of people for a few hundred bucks online. Not to mention that then why would you even buy Facebook likes? Then go and buy their credit card records, buy their web browsing logs, search logs. This data is much more revealing and much cheaper to obtain. So this is the first proof that they didn't know what they were doing really. Now the second proof that they didn't know what they were doing really is they were talking about what they were doing. And there are companies out there that have been doing the same thing for decades. And they just basically keep quiet about this. Have you heard any major politician, any major candidate ever coming out and saying what Donald Trump did or Ted Cruz did by hiring Cambridge Analytica, it's outrageous? Well, none of them did. Why? Because they all hired the same, well, smarter guys than Cambridge Analytica and spend much more money. Hillary Clinton spent $120 million on doing exactly what Donald Trump did using Cambridge Analytica. And as far as I know, well, I understand from the press, Donald Trump only spent $40 million. Doing this, right? So it's kind of fact of life now that politicians are using such methods to target their voters, which I'm sorry, I will kind of continue answering this question because I think there's another interesting question that could be asked here. So how bad is it that politicians are using customized, personalized political marketing? Well, not sure if you remember, but when Obama did it back in 2008, when he started communicating with voters and trying to understand them and then adjust, personalize the message to make it relevant for them, everyone was like so impressed how great Obama was that he's finally using those new tools to communicate with the voters. Now, and guess what? That's true that it's great that politicians do it. By trying to understand you better, understand your psychological traits, your interests, your dreams, a politician can make the message more engaging and more relevant to you. And I personally believe that engaged voters are great for the democracy. Second of all, if I can make my message relevant to you and engaging for you, then I don't need to spam you with yes we can or let's make America great again. I can just have much more informed and potentially shorter conversation with you where I talk about real issues that matter to you, and instead of spending, and I essentially can save money on political marketing. Now, if I as a political candidate can save money on political messaging communication, this means that we are decreasing the role of money in politics. I just essentially need less money. And this was illustrated by both Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders, who spend way less money than establishment candidates and yet successfully rallied substantial support by their successful communication. Now, this is the second thing. Now, the third thing is the following. If I can distinguish between voters with high accuracy, if I can check which one is extroverted, which one is introverted, which one is interested in guns, who is interested in healthcare and so on. If I can distinguish between you guys, this is useless as long as I don't have something to say to you that you would find interesting and engaging and convincing for you to vote for me. Which means that the logic of political communication changes. In the past, politicians try to find the common, common minimal denominator, smallest denominator, so kind of a message that would kind of attract everyone and no one really, and the largest possible audience, because they also had no way of knocking at your door and talking with you in person one-on-one. So this is why we have big slogans. Based on emotion, usually. Yes, we can, or let's make America great again. If I have a technology that allows me to essentially knock at your door and talk with you one-on-one about issues that you care about, then why should I be shouting yes, we can at you? I should be trying to understand what you find interesting and relevant and then talk about it with you, which means that personalized political communication means that political dialogue is moving more towards issues that people care about. And I think this is great, especially when those issues that people care about come from minorities. In the past, when you needed to make a TV ad and broadcast it to millions of people, you wouldn't be able to, it would make no sense to make this ad communicate about issues that mattered only to a small, tiny group. The logic, the economy of political marketing was such that it didn't make sense. Now that I can talk with you guys separately, suddenly the issues of minorities matter to me as a politician because I can get your votes by talking about them, right? So more weight is put now on the interest of minorities. And now, of course, having said that, you have to remember that technology like that can be used to make you more engaged in politics, but it can be also used to discourage you from voting. So at the end of the day, it's not the technology that is immoral. It's the potential user of the technology that can behave in an immoral fashion. And the lady there.
So you talked about how legislation and things like that in terms of privacy and protecting our privacy is no longer a viable option, but I wanted to ask, what would be a better option for us to protect our data and also protect against, like you said, users of data that want to abuse our privacy?
Well, I think that the safest approach would be to assume that essentially users do not have privacy. Because you can regulate Facebook, you can regulate Google. Very likely, you will make their services less useful, less convenient, and more expensive. Now, the money that companies spend on complying with privacy laws, at the end of the day, you guys, customers, are going to pay for it. The fact that innovation is now more difficult, you will pay the price because the solutions, the products and services they offer are going to be less innovative. The risk is that, in fact, now in other geographical locations, in other societies that are not as concerned with privacy, the progress will be faster, which will mean that maybe one day users from Europe will just find a way to go and use technologies developed by and hosted by Russians or Chinese because they will be faster, better, more convenient, cheaper, and so on. And if you say, oh no, this is not happening, well, I know plenty of Chinese people using Facebook, and even if it's banned in China, finding a way to use it. And also what I worry, and this is relates not only to GDPR, but also to kind of to the discussion on privacy technology, that it creates an illusion that if we just do the right thing, that we'll have a privacy, the privacy will be granted, and kind of put the difficult question of, hey, what to do if the, in the post-privacy world, puts it to kind of like, puts it to sleep. No one has to worry about it at the moment, because we just still believe that it may happen. And I'm not saying that getting ready for the post-privacy world is going to be an easy task, but it's something that we have to start considering now. Sir?
Thank you. I was just wondering what your thoughts are on blockchain and its role in the post-privacy world, as you put it.
I think it's a great question, and there's definitely a lot of potential in this technology. I'm just happen to know very little about blockchain, so I think that I would bore you with my uninformed answer here. Sir?
Yes, I read the other day that somebody said that privacy is a historical blip because nobody had it in a pre-industrial society. But my question really was about sort of national differences, where we see, you know, German Greens maybe particularly very concerned about privacy, but we've got huge use in, they're not emerging markets now, but in the new economies, maybe with different attitudes. What do you know about that?
I think it's a great question and great point as well, that not only cultures differ, but also one other thing that people often overlook is that, well, I personally, if I was given a choice, I would opt for as much privacy as people want for themselves. But there are disadvantages of privacy as well. If you are a tax evading corporation, you love your privacy. If you are a child abuser or a murderer, you love your privacy. Which essentially shows you that there's always a trade-off there. And my thinking is that while I'm not trying to say that I'm really happy about us losing our privacy, maybe if we just accepted this reality, we could then focus on trying to take as much advantage as possible from this fact, from essentially greater transparency. Let me give you one example. Forget about algorithms. If you are Google, you see hundreds of children Googling every day what to do if my uncle is sexually abusing me or touching me. Now, if a child sets something along those lines to me as a psychologist at work, I would be legally obliged to take action. Most likely in many countries, if a child said something of this kind to just a passerby, they probably also would be obliged to take action. Now, Google is obliged not to take action. So I'm not really sure what the right solution is there, but we have to remember that by requiring, by demanding that Google protects our privacy at all cost, we're paying price for it. We're paying price in abused children. We're paying price in suicides, in people who end their lives. While this could be prevented because Facebook or Google or whatever other platform they're using or the smartphone could be used to predict that are going to commit suicide and then call for help. Right, so there's always a trade-off that I think that many, and I'm one of the privacy activists, but I think that we always overlook that we are paying price for demanding privacy every single day. Madam?
Can you tell us what you know about whether actually people care about their privacy? Because it strikes me that when there have been big data breaches recently, say the Uber data breach, there have been other companies that have had massive data breaches, it hasn't really affected the bottom line or the number of users they have. And in a world where, as you say, we have such enormous footprints of our data, do you think there's anything to be gained as a corporation from not monetizing the data? I mean, it's a slightly separate question, but first of all, do people really care? And second of all, is there anything to be gained as a corporation from not exploiting user data, given the arms race you described earlier?
That's a great question. So, two questions actually here. So, the monetizing question. What was the? I'm sorry, I just got distracted with the monetizing question. Can you repeat the first question?
Whether people care.
Oh, whether people care? Yes, people don't care, of course. And the best example is there are 2 billion Facebook users. If people really cared, would they be on Facebook? And now, of course, I don't want to inspire anyone to leave Facebook, because guess what? Facebook is just not really revealing. It's not the most revealing platform out there. Your credit card is way more revealing about your behavior and intimate traits. Your web browsing history, your search history. Essentially, if you really wanted to prevent companies and governments and hackers from having access to your digital footprints, you would have to get rid of all modern technology, which would be bad, not only for you as an individual, but to a society as well. I don't want my friends to stop using Facebook. I quite enjoy interacting with them on this platform. I don't want people to stop using Google Maps. Look, people also keep forgetting that sharing the data is not only something that relates to me, but also to the rest of the society. If I was given a choice whether I want to share my geographical location with Google or not, I would say, of course not. Why would I expose myself to this risk? But now, if everyone did this, then you don't have Google Maps, which means that millions of people, if not billions of people, would need more time to get to work every morning. Imagine the economical cost for individuals and economies of that. That millions of people would burn more gas. Imagine the price of maintaining the privacy of a geographical location for the environment. And finally, consider the lives lost by the fact that emergency services that also rely on the data generated by Google Maps, by our geographical location, to predict the traffic and optimize the route to go and save someone's life from fire or heart attack or whatnot, there will be price paid also in lives. Now you can extend this thinking to academic research. If I'm given a choice to keep my health data private, of course I'm keeping my health data private. Why would I risk that someone will refuse insurance to me in the future based on some prediction? But now if we all did this, we're stifling research in medical sciences. We're slowing down the development of new diagnostic tools, new treatments, and so on. So I believe essentially that data is a bit like taxes, that no one here loves paying taxes, but we all, and probably no one here would pay taxes if they were just the only person in the world that were left to pay taxes. But we kind of all agreed as societies that we'll contribute part of our income every year to make the society is better, a better place. And I think it's very much the same with the data. And one could argue even that if you can afford losing your privacy, you probably should lose your privacy as soon as possible. If you are Germany, which has beautiful insurance laws, where revealing your healthcare data is not going to cost you much in terms of access to insurance, you probably owe it to those poor Americans who can't do this to reveal your health data as a society to drive academic research. If you are gay and you are in a position, such position in the society that you wouldn't be killed by the fact that you revealed that, you probably should do this. And this is why Harvey Milk revealed his sexual orientation. He took the risk and he paid the highest price. But thanks to him and people like him who voluntarily lost their privacy, it's now much safer to be gay in America than it used to be 20 or 30 years ago. Sir?
The place where the rubber hits the road is really behavior modification. You talked about commercial behavior modification by companies who want to advertise to you. My question relates to government behavior modification of the lines we saw with the Russian voter suppression in America, that kind of thing. One of the things we learned in the Cambridge Analytica scandal is that the parent company, SCL, had done psychological warfare operations in Iraq. My question is a question, if you were to write the history of this field that you've been in for a long time, how important are the intelligence services of different countries in funding the field and in developing the field?
It's a great question. I don't have an answer to how important the intelligence agencies are. I'll be the last person that any intelligence agency, because I have a big mouth, would want to share any information of this with me. But one thing here is that digital media democratized access to communication channels. In the past, only members of establishment that controlled radio and TV and newspapers and wealthy individuals were able to essentially communicate with large numbers of people. These days, you can be a celebrity or an interesting politician, someone outside of the establishment, and you can get a serious traction, not only through your own communication, but also all of those retweets and reposts. So the access essentially to communication channels is democratized. Now, you mentioned how Americans were using, you mentioned manipulation as well, because of course, people fear being manipulated. If I know your psychological traits, I can manipulate you much better. And this is something that's obvious to everyone. Look, when you talk to people and you want to convince them to do something, you don't just have the same spiel for everyone. You will try to see what's interesting for this person, what kind of psychological leverages you can use. You will try to manipulate your child into washing their hands in a very different way that you would try to manipulate your parents to doing something else. You would use a different psychological warfare there, depending on the age and personality of a person. And psychological warfare sounds very bad, but you can also use manipulation to do great things, like convince people to wash their hands or stop smoking or pay their insurance or pay taxes. So very much like in the context of marketing, it all depends on the morals of the person who is communicating. Look, America was really trying to manipulate people in a communist Poland. When I was a kid, you know, you could read in our local newspaper, The Truth, Pravda, about, you know, those bloody Americans dropping those Xerox machines on parachutes or smuggling them to Poland so the democratic opposition could copy their leaflets. From the point of view of the Soviet Union, this was an awful thing to do. From the point of view of many citizens of the country, including me being able now to stand on this stage, it was just a tremendous service that Americans provided to Polish society. So very often what's one person's manipulation and propaganda is another person's message of freedom or change for better. And I think we have time for one last question, sir.
Okay, my name is Barry Tomlin, Birkbeck College, London. There's something missing here. And for me, what's missing right the way through, although you might want to say it's underneath, is the moral issue. We are looking at an increasingly algorithmic universe. We can do the statistics. We know what to do. We know what we think we want to do. Where is the room for judgment about what is the right thing to do and what is the wrong thing to do? Because right now we are seeing huge examples of algorithmic thinking causing massive problems on a global scale. I'd like to know how you react to that.
Well, thank you for this point. And actually, I would respectfully disagree with those massive examples of algorithmic thinking that are making things worse, because apart from well-known examples, algorithms have changed the world for better in so many areas. Our life expectancy, our access to education, our access to technology, how we travel to work in the morning using Google Maps, how cars and planes became safer, how the decision of politicians in self-respecting countries are now supported by algorithms that crunch through the data suggesting how to improve healthcare systems and monetary systems and so on. So I believe that technology and algorithms specifically improved our societies to an enormous degree. And let me even give you an extreme example. Look, law is just an algorithm. It's a simple algorithm compared with modern computer algorithms, but legal codes are just algorithms. If this happens, this is what you're supposed to do. And you can, of course, say, well, where's the role for a human judgment if now decisions are made by this soulless algorithm called civil law? And yet, I think we all enjoy living in an algorithm-driven society where decisions are not left to individuals who sometimes are great, but sometimes are evil. So I believe that actually taking some decision powers away from humans, who have a tendency to be tired sometimes, angry sometimes, corrupt, revengeful, and giving those decisions to algorithms, like laws, for instance, is probably one of the greatest achievements of the humankind, despite all of the drawbacks as well, which we should really try to address. Great. And I think this was our last question, and there was an invitation for the reception upstairs. Thank you very much.